All right, everybody, welcome to BO Boys for Wednesday, December 4th. Fuck it, it's a raw feed. We're doing it live. I'm Clayton.
Yeah, I'm Pat. Clayton, it's cold out there. Maybe it's cold outside, which means it's winter, which means it's time for our seasonal winter preview, and we can't do it alone. We can't just do it just the boys. We had to bring in our big double issue seasonal preview expert, companion, co-host, the man himself. We haven't seen him since we were on stage together in LA, but he's here with us virtually from Exhibitor Relations Co. The one and only Jeff Bock is here. Welcome to the BO Boys, Jeff.
Thanks for having me, guys. It's special. You know, whenever I get that EW double stacked edition, you get so excited. Like, it's a pleasure, man. It's like I'm sitting in my tub at home, opening that thing and just sitting in there for like 2 hours. And I know it'll probably go 2 hours tonight. That's how we do it. At least, right?
At least. I mean, somehow, you look at this slate of movies for December, January, February, you wouldn't think we could go 2 hours, but 2 hours guaranteed. We're guaranteeing it here.
That's a midnight for you guys. I mean, you guys are going till midnight.
Oh, yeah. We're going past midnight. We got to when you got all these Lionsgate releases clogging up the January schedule. But this is the double issue. I love, Jeff, that to you, reading EW, it's in the bathtub. It's nice and relaxed. You know, for me, I'm a New Yorker, so I pick up that double issue off the newsstand, and then it's a two-hour train ride, and it gets me through.
Yeah. Checking that mailbox. Is it here? Come on. Is it here? Yeah, it's here. Mm-hmm. Jump right in that tub, because in North Idaho, where I grew up, it's cold, man. It's cold. Mm. I don't know if it's New York cold. We don't get the wind, but it's snow ice cold in North Idaho, you know?
So you're taking a scalding hot bath.
Oh, yeah.
Burning your skin as you read that double EW issue.
Oh, yeah. And sometimes, you know, when you get water on those magazines, they stick a little bit, but it's worth it, man. You just devour that thing and then you're done with it. You devour it, you know?
Yeah.
That's how hopefully the fans will devour this one, because this is a big show.
So everyone, draw a scalding hot bath and get your radio out and listen to this BO Boys winter preview episode. So guys, we're going to get into it. So again, it's going to cover December and then January and February of 2025. That is the winter in box office terms. So let's start with, you know, this month, obviously the movies, the next couple of weeks, we'll be talking a lot about it here on the show, but this Friday, let's say Friday, December 6th starts the winter box office, not quite starting with a bang. Is there anything, Jeff, that you think is going to break out this weekend? I mean, I'm seeing Y2K from Kyle Mooney, the SNL, someone who has been on SNL. Don't know if people remember his run on SNL, but he was on SNL. So there's a comedy called Y2K from A24. And then movies from IFC Films, Bleecker Street, and Briarcliff Entertainment. That is the murderer's row of studios.
This is the definition of shit show weekend. And we all know how this goes. Like, they just throw out a whole bunch of wide releases. They get maybe one or two okay showtimes. They don't even get the big screens. I mean, let's face it. Moana 2, Gladiator 2, Wicked. Those are taking still. Those are going to take the big theaters all the way up until we get bigger releases like Kraven the Hunter, maybe Lord of the Rings, and then obviously Sonic and Mufasa. But until then, these films are gonna struggle to even get like four show times a day. Mm-hmm. And so you know what that means at the box office. These are all like bargain basement misses. Maybe Y2K hits, I think, maybe in metropolitan markets, but werewolves, where's the marketing for this? Mm-hmm. You know, where's the marketing for any of these? Solo Leveling, Reawakening, it's a Crunchyroll film. It's only going in 900 theaters. No, the biggest thing that we got going on, honestly, this weekend is that Interstellar 10th anniversary reissue on IMAX for all those Christopher Nolan fans. That'll probably, honestly, might make more than any of these films.
Wow. Okay, so you think that the Interstellar re-release is going to make more than The Return from Bleecker Street?
Oh God, I'd bet my box office card on it. I'll bet my card on it.
Wow. You know what I think when I see this slate here, IFC Films, Bleecker Street, new COVID variant dropping.
Yeah.
Huh?
This is some July 2020 stuff. When you see IFC Films and Bleecker Street being the wide releases, that scares you. That sends shivers up your spine.
New COVID stepping down on the bricks.
One, two, three. I count four, maybe five wide releases. Guys, you guys know I'm in the business of tracking how many films go into how many movie theaters. I don't even have the information on these films. The studios didn't even send them out last week. Like usually a week before, you'll get a count, an estimated count of how many theaters these films are going to be in. The only one I got was from Crunchyroll. Solo Leveling, they said 900-ish, which is barely a wide release. Mm-hmm. Night Bitch didn't even tell me if they're – Searchlight didn't even say if they're going limited or wide. It used to be wide, but I don't think it's going wide. I haven't heard anything about this. This script was hot when it came out, and Night Bitch was going to – I mean, Twitter loved the name Night Bitch. Everybody wants to say Night Bitch, right? But
it's a great, great thing. Let's all say Night Bitch. Clayton, get in on this.
Night Bitch.
Yeah.
Yes.
There you go.
That was very good.
That felt great.
And it feels good. Yeah. Feels good. But again, where's the advertising? You know, where's the communication with people that are trying to help promote your movies? You know, it's just not there. Mm-hmm. They are taking the week off. And that's what, like Clayton said, that's when Briarcliff comes to the table. That's when Wellgo USA is at the table. IFC Films, Neon. You know, everybody wants a piece of this shit show.
Yeah. Magnolia Pictures is getting on this. We got Vertical Entertainment has a limited release with The Order. It is Wellgo USA, it looks like, has two different limited releases this weekend.
Yeah.
This is the end of year sort of for tax purposes releases where they want to get stuff off the books. Basically, that's what this December 6th weekend it is. Get stuff off the books so that you don't pay taxes on it next year. So, yeah, I don't think this weekend's going to be much to write home about at the box office. But look at it the next couple of weeks of December. Kraven the Hunter. You know, this has been a movie that's been delayed about three or four times. I think at one point it was coming out. Maybe at the end of 2023, I think it's been pushed back an entire year at some point. And I'm hearing the buzz on this recently. Some buzz saying it's not as bad as you think. So, Jeff, you're out there and they're like, Clayton shaking his head. Is there any... Okay, here's what I'll pose with Kraven the Hunter. It seems like Sony is trying to downplay the superhero aspect of this, downplay the Spider-Man universe connection, and just sell this as a action movie. Yeah. Is that a possible winning strategy? Just, hey, Kraven the Hunter's got this jacked up guy who's going to punch people in the face. Don't worry about the Marvel stuff. Is that a way to go? Is there any hope for Kraven the Hunter?
I think it was the only way to go. For Sony and Marvel, because of what happened with Morbius and obviously the disaster that was Madame Web. You know, you're talking about Morbius made 167 million worldwide. Madame Web just cracked 100 million worldwide. And that's just not enough for these films that cost, you know, even if they're bargain basement, 70, 80 million, you're spending another 50 million on advertising. You're not even breaking even at the box office. And certainly, even if they lease them out to Netflix, Netflix isn't going to pay a lot for Madame Web and Kraven the Hunter's probably in the same boat. I will say that I did like the newest trailer a little bit better than the last one. But again, like we talked about this is the wrong story that they went with. They went with some rogue Kraven the Hunter story that has nothing to do with the comic books, really, that I know of, maybe bits and pieces. And Aaron Taylor Johnson he has never been a draw. Ever. And that is still true. So I just don't see what Sony was going for. And how can you not put a cameo of Spider-Man in here or a cameo of Venom in here? Like, you own this universe. What the fuck are you doing, Sony? Honestly, it kind of makes me mad of how inept they've treated these spinoffs to not include some of the major characters from Spider-Man in it.
Mm-hmm.
You should put, Tom Holland. Right? You should have him in every one of these movies. There's no excuse.
Yes.
Put it in. No, you should have put it in his contract that he has to show up for every shitty thing connected to this universe, because you are a Sony. You're a Sony IP. Like, don't get it twisted. You are a Sony IP. We own your ass. Like, I know Paul. I know Paul. Not Paul Feig. Jesus. What am I thinking? Kevin Feige. I know Kevin Feige is, you know, he's been in a role in like helping the Spider-Man movies and stuff like that. But otherwise, if this kid's under contract, put him in whatever trash you want. Put him in. Put, I mean, Spider-Man, you should have had him in Ghostbusters, the Frozen Empire.
Just it's in New York. There. It's in New York.
Yeah. It would have been easy for him. Yeah.
He just swings through from Queens. Oh, just stopping by. You know, hey, Venkman. And just Sony, swings right by.
Let's be honest. Sony doesn't know what they're doing. Sony does not know what they're doing with these Marvel movies. They should have had him in the last Venom movie, The Last Dance. He should have showed up. In fact, I was so positive it was going to happen. You could have added another $100 million if you just put Tom Holland in it for 10 seconds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, that's the thing is like, I think that, you know, it's not like this kid has quality control. Anyway, he does these Apple movies. He's doing, you know, he's doing all this junk that all these other people are doing. So it's like, if he shows up in Craven, it's not like it's going to diminish him as any sort of star.
So Clayton, you seem to be much more down on the Craven prospects than I think I am.
Oh,
do 15 million is what I just looked up, what Madam Web opened to this year. Isn't it amazing that Madam Web came out this year? It feels like 15 years ago. Came out in February, opened to 15 million. Do you think Craven is doing less than that?
It's possible this thing flies to the moon.
Wow. Single digits, 4.5 million or under. Wow. Craven could fly to the moon.
Here's the options. It flies to the moon. Or it flies with the Angels, which would be 7 million.
Okay.
I think it's probably going to do 9.
Okay. Wow.
I think it's a stinker and a half.
That's rough. That's rough.
I think this is a stinker and a half. Because look at what you have up against it. I mean, you have massive movies that people want to see. You know? I mean, I think Red One's going to eat this thing's lunch. Because nobody cares about Craven. Nobody cares about this kid. And the only thing that people might have an interest in is Russell Crowe is in it. And they're like, oh, I saw Gladiator 2 and I missed this guy. So maybe I want to see him in something. That's the only possibility for this movie to make in the teens. Is that
it's a Gladiator bump.
There's nostalgia for
It's also rated Crow. R, right? It wasn't Morbius.
Morbius, I think, was PG-13.
Yeah.
Yeah. And wasn't Morbius PG-13?
Yeah, I think Morbius was PG-13.
Are going for that R. Yeah, they're going for that hard R action crowd. And so, you know, Pat, I think you're right. Like, they just said, hey, forget Marvel, F Marvel on this one. Let's just get that hard R-rated action crowd into this thing. They don't need to know that it's Marvel or associated with Spider-Man, because guess what, guys? He's not in it anyway. So, again, they might succeed in that way. And for me, if they succeed... For me, that's like, you know, 13, 14 million debut.
Wow.
That would be a success for that hard R-rated action crowd in December, right?
Yes.
Like,
it's a Jerry Butler movie without Jerry Butler, basically.
Yeah, exactly. And that's it's an IMAX. It's the week after this shit show that's coming up.
Yeah.
And people, you know, maybe they're a little hungry for a little action, you know? But it's like, if that or Lord of the Rings, the War of...
What is this Lord of the Rings, the War of Aurora? This is an animated film. Is this basically for Warner Brothers to just be able to keep the Lord of the Rings IP? Is this a Roger Corman's Fantastic Four situation? Yeah. Like, you're just holding on to it so you produce a cheapie? Is that what's going on here? Or is this
think this is cheapy at all, Pat. This is something I think this will make more money than Craven.
Okay.
Because this has been... This has been my, opening weekend. This has been my sort of thing that I've been talking about for a long time, is that the future of these franchises is animation, is adult animation, is that there's a generation that watches anime, that has grown up on anime, that wants to, you know, watch these sort of franchises in an animated form. I don't think they think animation is for babies at all. I think animation is for babies. They don't. You know, they're in their 20s and 30s and they're still watching cartoons, right? So, yeah. Like, this, I think, is going to do surprisingly well because Lord of the Rings, you know, put aside the TV shows that cost $1 billion and people sort of watch but don't. I think that there is a lot of hunger for big screen Lord of the Rings content.
Yeah, this is an interesting one. I think it's going to be a big test for your theory, Clayton, of whether you could start taking live action IP and releasing, you know, doing the reverse of what you're seeing with, you know, Mufasa coming out in a few weeks, where you're taking the animated stuff and going live action. That's been a success for Disney. But can you animate these live action movies and still replicate it? I mean, Jeff, is this Warner Brothers taking an honest shot at a blockbuster, or is this my theory that it's more of a we gotta pump out a Lord of the Rings movie or else we'll lose the rights?
I'll be honest, I was big on this over Comic-Con or CinemaCon, but you guys know I get totally hyped up for CinemaCon, and they showed a little bit, and I thought the thing is, I thought Warner Brothers was big on this, but when we look at films and how they're released and how they are sold to the general public, that's a key marker on whether or not a film's going to be successful, right? Guess what? Warner Brothers is not advertising the shit out of this like they're it's not a blockbuster at all, right? And that's my concern about this film is you guys are Lord of the Rings, one of the biggest IPs in Hollywood. Most people don't even know this shit. They don't know the title and they don't know it's coming out in 2 weeks, you guys. That is a problem. And it makes me think that Warner Brothers doesn't have any faith in this thing. Now, Warner Brothers, you know, they're kind of a mess over there anyways, right? Like we've seen what they've been doing, just tax write-offs and things like that. But they're putting this out there with not a lot of momentum behind it. Is that anime crowd that kind of disappeared for Crunchyroll actually going to show up to this? I have my concerns because I know my dad and you know, the boomers, they don't want to see this film. They don't even know that it's coming out, you know, and my dad and boomers love Lord of the Rings. He loves the TV series, for God's sakes. Right. I think it's unwatchable, but he loves it. You know what I mean? But the thing is, I just don't think this is for him, and I'm not sure who this is for, actually. Yeah. And that's my biggest concern, and that's why I think, Pat, you might be right that they had to put out something to keep it in the bin. And I think Peter Jackson maybe was an executive producer on this. If that's
he got his beak wet. That feels like, you know, you pay him to give his thumbs up, basically. Yeah, but I don't think he's contributing here.
Yeah, there's not any support from Warner Brothers on this thing, and that gives me caution to say that it can open over even 15 million, you know, which is okay, but it's nothing to shout about next weekend when it gets crushed by Sonic and Mufasa.
Right.
And loses all its IMAX screens and is in a theater of 20 seats after that, you know, so it has one weekend.
Right. I have yet to see, and I've been to all the blockbuster movies of the last few weeks, went to Wicked, went to Gladiator 2, haven't seen this trailer yet.
No, we saw it together.
This trailer?
Yeah, we saw this trailer together.
In front of what?
The last movie we saw together. It was on. We saw it.
I don't remember seeing this trailer at all.
Yeah. Uh-oh. Yeah. No, we. It was definitely the last movie me and you saw together. This trailer was in front of it. 100%.
What was the movie?
Because we didn't see Gladiator together. We didn't see Wicked together. What would this have even been?
This was a couple weeks ago.
I don't remember this. And if you can't remember the movie.
It was Red One.
Red One.
They showed this in front of Red One in Boston. Okay. I missed that. I don't know if I was, you know, cleaning our collector's Red One popcorn bucket. Maybe that was happening. I believe you. I haven't seen this trailer. We watched a lot of football last weekend over Thanksgiving. We are Penn State. Clayton and I were watching a lot of football. Yeah. No commercials for this during football. I agree with Jeff. I don't think that the marketing push is strong on this at all. They're not promoting it the way they would thinking they have a blockbuster here. The main voice cast is.
Are they promoting this towards like anime fans? Like, are they promoting on channels that we are not on?
If they're promoting it towards anime fans, then the ceiling is low. You know, this has not been.
It should be on HBO Max. It should be like, it's not on a banner there. And that's, you know, it's going to play big, probably on HBO Max is where it's going to be biggest.
Yeah.
You got to let the people know, hey, go see this in theaters before it winds up on HBO Max in a couple months, you know? And I saw a trailer for The Return, Bleecker Street's goddamn film. I was watching some sports thing and there was the trailer for The Return on the middle of a big sports thing. Like it was NFL or NBA or something. I'm like, oh my God, Bleecker Street is spending more money than Warner Brothers, right?
Yeah.
On a film over the holiday. Cause you know, everybody's watching sports last week in America. And, and that is the time to hit them. I saw so many Kraven the Hunter ads. At least Sony is trying, you know, they can't say that they didn't spend the money cause they did. I've seen it, but Lord of the Rings, it's almost like it doesn't exist.
Yeah, that is the thing. Kraven the Hunter is being put out there as if it was a big, real movie. This Lord of the Rings movie, I think, is just for the anime fans, and we've seen the ceiling for that, those Crunchyroll movies. I mean, we're talking back in spring 2021 was probably the high watermark, and even that was 24 million. So I think that's what we're looking at.
Okay, well, I still think it makes more than Kraven because Kraven is going to crater. That's the thing. It's like if this thing makes 11 and Kraven makes 9, then I'm right.
Then you're right that this would have made more.
Having to make $24 million because Kraven ain't going to make $24 million.
You win, then the industry loses because this is
that's it. Yeah,
it's unfortunate. You know,
and I would rather lose. Listen. I hope Kraven makes 70. I hope Kraven makes $100 million and I look like the stupidest man in America.
That would be scary though. If Kraven opened to $100 million, then things have gone wrong.
Then
Y2K has happened. Yeah.
Yeah. But if it like Madam Web only did 15, if it opens under Madam Web, it is just, that's it. Like does Sony even go back in and try anything outside of Spider-Man or Venom after that?
Oh, they're so stupid. They're so dumb. They probably will. They're so dumb. They should have canceled this movie. Like, they should have put a gun to Tom Holland's head and told him to get his ass in that suit and stop dancing around like, who's he doing the biopic of? Bob Fosse or whatever. And
get in that Spider-Man suit and
go fight Venom.
Go fight Venom. Go fight Venom. Go fight Kraven. Go hang out with Kraven. Do whatever it is you do with Kraven. We don't know their relationship.
Go have shawarma with Kraven.
Go have shawarma with Kraven. So
even if they swarm at the end of the movie.
Bring in a Spider-Man that isn't even Tom Holland or anybody else that we know. Bring in a Spider-Man so Kraven the Hunter can kill him like he did in the comic books, you know, or at least make that part of it because Kraven is only interesting because he's hunting Spider-Man. We don't care that, you know, he's hunting Mufasa or whoever the hell he's hunting in this movie, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Bring in Jake Johnson from the animated Spider-Man movies and just have him kill Jake Johnson in the first
act. We're all good with that.
We're all good with Kraven killing Jake Johnson. So the next 2 weeks are rough. December is not looking so hot these first two weekends, but then on the 20th, we've got some big movies, but just how big will they be? Mufasa the Lion King from Disney, Sonic the Hedgehog 3 from Paramount. Now, we're going to be covering those movies in a preview episode. We got a very special guest who's specifically excited to talk about Sonic 3. Our listeners could guess who that might be. But, Jeff, is Mufasa going to be gigantic? You know, is Mufasa going to be at the level of those other live action of the animated hit remakes? We saw The Lion King, we saw Beauty and the Beast. Is Mufasa got a chance to be anywhere near that? Like, you know, as down as
Twitter and social media is on The Lion King, and it really is kind of unjustified. I mean, guess what? Nobody asked for this. Well, nobody really asked for Moana 2 either. And we saw what happened there. I mean, Disney didn't even know that people would go see this in the theater. They almost put it straight to streaming. Lion King is a beast, you guys. Mm-hmm. It is massive. It covers Broadway. It covers multiple films. The last one did $1.6 billion worldwide. Dude, it opened at 191 million. And yeah. I know people hate it. Everybody hated it. Guess what? They didn't hate it. In fact, overseas, it did 1.1 billion by itself internationally, wow. Right? So wow. That's the key. That is the demographic. Disney could care less what North America really thinks about this because it's going to make so much money overseas. It doesn't really matter. Like Sonic's going to be great, but The Lion King, I can't. It's going to gross more than Sonic 3. It just is, you guys. It's Disney. They're on a roll. This thing, when you watch the trailer, you're like, no family member is going to say, you know what? I don't want to see that with my family. You know mm-hmm. what? You're going to go. The same reason you went to Wicked and went to Moana 2 with your family, because it is a big time family flick that everybody knows its name. And yeah, it's a prequel, and I fucking hate prequels too, just as much as the last guy. But guess what? It's more Lion King mythology. It's the characters you know and love. Doesn't matter if I like it or you like it or Clayton likes it, but people are going to make this the de facto family film over the holidays and into January and February. I can't see how it loses. As much as there's a lot of hate out there, Disney's in a good place right now.
Yep.
And this is the right film at the right time.
Yeah. And it's playing before the Moana trailers. I'm sure Disney Plus is going to be pushing that on the homepage like crazy, which is an under-talked about aspect of the marketing for these movies, is now that the streamers, especially Disney Plus, could just put Mufasa on that homepage. And the kids are on that constantly. They're seeing that. And Mufasa's the guy. People love Mufasa. Good.
Yeah.
You know, and we've never gotten a lot of Mufasa in the other versions of Lion King. He's always, he's cool up top and then he goes away. And so it's not the prequel situation of what happened to the main character when he was a little kid. It's what happened to the old guy that you like when he was a strapping young lion. I agree. I think this could be gigantic. I mean, Clayton, you obviously, you know, kid stuff, not for you specifically, but do you think Mufasa could be on par with some of those big Disney, you know, live action remakes of the last few years?
Well, Lion King made 191 in its opening, correct?
Yeah. Bananas
and,
number.
And I mean, obviously, I don't think that is going to happen because that was an existing, you know, film that people already sort of knew what was going to happen. So this is a new thing. And so I think it'll make less, but I still think it's going to do great numbers because, you know, it's a safe choice. Like it's just a safe choice. Like you guys were saying, it's a family film. You know what you're getting lions. People love lions. I don't know what it's about. I don't know the quality. I don't even know if you can judge the quality of this. You know what I mean? Like, I think that it's going to do really well. I don't see this thing missing. Now, do I see it making half a billy domestic? Probably not, but it could.
Here's my long range take. I think it will, because this opens on December 20th, and it basically has what? 14 plus days of people generally being off from work and off from school, you know, December 20th through that first week in January, it is just the kids are home every day. If you got an office job, you're home. Obviously, if you're working in the mines, if you're working in the factories, you're working. But otherwise, people are home for 2 weeks. This is just going to play like crazy. Just every weekday is going to be like a weekend for this thing. It's going to be gigantic.
And then we know how desolate January and February are for kids picks and family flicks. So guys, it's going the distance. It's going to March, you know? Paddington in Peru is the only kids film. And then obviously Captain America opened in mid February. But again, Lion King is just going to eat. It's going to eat. And that's what it's going to do. And that and Sonic are going to just both be great for what they are, because it's the Wicked Gladiator punch of the Christmas holiday. That's what's going to happen. You got 14 days. You got a huge window. That is the second best corridor in terms of box office over Christmas. I still think Thanksgiving is the best, but very close behind is that Christmas corridor. And with those two films playing back to back, they're going to eat well.
Yeah. I mean, we're covering December, January, February. Is it a safe bet to say Mufasa just domestically will be the biggest movie that opens in those 3 months? Is there a bigger winter blockbuster than Mufasa? Can anything make more?
No, it would be a surprise. I mean, we can shift over to Sonic here. I mean, Sonic 1 opened at 58 million. The second one opened at 72 worldwide. The second one hit over 400 while the first one did what, 320. So it's on the up and up, right? But how much more can it go? Like, has Sonic 3 hit the peak, or is this Keanu Reeves? We added Keanu. Is that going to push us up another 50 million, another 100 million, or are we at that level? Because I always, like, you know, you think of Pirates of the Caribbean and it was so great. And then Dead Man's Chest opened so much bigger because everybody was so excited about the first one. And then at World's End, and it starts to taper off. And usually by that third film, we do see some tapering off. So what do you guys think? What is Sonic 3? Is it still on the up and up?
Well, I mean, my thing is just both of those Sonic movies, correct me if I'm wrong, but those were like February, March releases, or maybe April. They were spring movies. This is Sonic getting to play through Christmas, and we have never seen that. And Sonic is one of those characters that is synonymous with Christmas, because every kid remembers getting a Sonic game as a Christmas gift. You know, Sonic sneakily is one of the great Christmas characters of the last 30 years, just by virtue of how often he is gifted and played with at Christmas. So I think getting to see a Sonic movie as a Christmas release is what takes this to the next level. Even if the interest in the movie isn't higher, I just think the release window is so much better than Sonic has ever gotten up to this point.
So you think, because it opens against Mufasa, it may not reach those 72 million opening, but it'll get there. It'll cruise past probably, 200 million domestic. The last one did 190. I could see that because of how weak January and February are, that Sonic and Mufasa just keep back-to-back-to-back high-fiving each other all the way through.
Yeah, I mean, the thing, look at something like those Jumanji movies. Those Jumanji movies, you come out in December, and they're family movies. They're also boy movies.
Yeah.
You know, there's enough action in there that teenagers will go, guys in their young 20s will go. Like, I think this plays to a different audience than just what Mufasa. I mean, Mufasa plays to everyone. It's going to be much bigger. But I think Sonic gives you a little something different for those Christmas weeks. You know, I think this is going to be the biggest one of the three, just because of how much it'll make on those weekdays over Christmas and New Year's. So those, you know, December gets better. It gets better. Christmas Day, there's not a blockbuster then coming out on Christmas Day. So December 20th is a Friday, then Christmas Day is the following Wednesday. I mean, this is probably not a crazy thing to say, but I think Clayton and I are really on the train for a complete unknown, the Bob Dylan movie with Chalamet. We both think that could be pretty big.
I agree.
And it seems like the clear new Christmas movie that's going to break out of the pack. So have you heard anything? Where are you at on this Bob Dylan movie?
Yeah, it's getting all the right buzz over in LA too, and they're promoting it quite a bit. Searchlight knows it's got something here. You know, Chalamet probably gets that. He gets that nomination, right? He's going to get that nomination. Maybe gets a Best Picture nom as well. And if that happens, you know, we could be talking about, you know, 50, 60 million for this film, which would be huge for Searchlight. They don't get films that gross, you know, 50, 60 million anymore. This isn't Little Miss Sunshine, you know, days anymore, you know? So that would be huge for Chalamet. Maybe they'll do the monthly Chalamet lookalike contest. Did any of you guys show up for that?
We did not. I didn't go to that because I knew I had heard the rumors that Chalamet himself was going to show up there, and I didn't want to show him up.
No,
I didn't
want to
go there and be a better Chalamet than Chalamet himself. Yeah. I feel like that might have hurt his box office. Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, this is James.
I'm too swole. I'm too swole to look like Timothy Chalamet.
Yeah. Well, he has a look. Guys, this is James Mangold. He's a great director. This is I can't wait for this film. Like, out of all the releases this December, I cannot wait for A Complete Unknown. Nosferatu is that other one that opens on Christmas Day. This is Robert Eggers' film. You know, it's been getting kind of middling reviews. Those early reviews came out. They weren't smashing like I thought they would be. If you're a fan of Eggers, you're going to go see this. But the box office hopes of this one, I think we're riding on really excellent reviews. So this puts it in. I mean, is it the Northmen? I mean, the Northmen only grossed like $70 million worldwide. I think it maybe does better than that, but not by much. 100 worldwide is okay. I don't know what this thing costs, but I know that he keeps getting more money thrown at him for every film that he does. And it looks expensive. I mean, he does a great job. The mise en scène of this film is extraordinary. Like, I look at it, I'm like, oh, that's a piece of art. But all his other films are too, and it doesn't translate to box office, though. And we know that, unfortunately.
Now, Jeff, you were there for the live show in L.A. You were one of the distinguished guests on the panel. And you saw our In Memoriam. You saw our In Memoriam for IPs, for actors. And Dracula was on that.
Yep.
So Nosferatu, you can zhuzh up the name as much as you want, but that motherfucker is Dracula.
Yeah.
Right? You Dracula, son. Okay.
Yeah.
So we have called it dead, and I don't know if this is completely dead, but it doesn't bode well for Nosferatu.
Yeah, it's Renfield, it's Last Voyage of the Demeter, and now it's Nosferatu.
Abigail.
Oh, yeah, I mean, Abigail. Dracula. This could be the final nail in his coffin. This could be what keeps the coffin closed for good, is if Nosferatu opens to like $7 or $8 million and does Lighthouse numbers. Want to go back to quickly Complete Unknown, because
I didn't get to say anything.
Well, yeah, you're high on this, Jeff, and you're saying $50 million would be great. I mean, Clayton, I'll let you speak to this because I think we're in the same boat. I mean, I think this has a chance to truly break out. When you look at what the Bar Marley movie did, One Love, Rockin' Man, this is not going to be Bohemian Rhapsody, but this is Dylan. I mean, Clayton, do you think this is a movie that could get itself to $100 million domestic?
The only thing that scares me, it's a Searchlight. That's the one thing that scares me, because it seems like a perfect storm of this young actor who has a string of hits and will bring in the youngsters. And then you've got Bob Dylan, who is a perennial just IP. He's got so many songs people know. The boomers will go see it because it's Dylan. And this looks like the only Bob Dylan movie that is in the at all palatable to a regular audience. Yeah. Right. So they're finally going to get this story before they die, because boomers are getting old. Like, they are dying. So this is their chance to see Bob Dylan on screen before they die.
Yeah. They're not retiring, but they are dying. They'll never retire, but they will. They will die.
Well, they're reinventing retirement by dying. So, so this is. I think it's a perfect storm. I think that this Christmas corridor. I just worry that, you know, I see a lot of promotion for it, but I just worry that it's Searchlight. Like, if this was even Warner Brothers, which, you know, we're down on.
I know,
but I mean, what they did with Elvis, like, I just and Mangold, like. It's a director that adults like, you know, when he's not doing Indiana Jones, and it's songs people like. It's a hot star. Like, I do think this thing could make $100 million. And if it doesn't, Searchlight bungled it.
I just, I do wonder, outside of major metropolitan areas and intellectuals, if people really like Bob Dylan. That's what I always, like, do they really love his music, or do they just kind of know him as an icon for, you know, saying F you to the man? You know, I think Chalamet is the right choice. I think that was the best bet to sell this film, for him to take this role. But I still wonder if, here's the thing, do people care about Bob Dylan anymore? Yeah.
We asked that about Bob Marley.
Well, but I agree with Bob Marley. My daughter still listens to Bob Marley. All the kids today know who Bob Marley is and are listening to Bob Marley. You can't say that about Bob Dylan, unfortunately.
Kids don't listen to Blonde on Blonde. They're not listening to Self Portrait.
They're listening to ABBA still. You know, Mamma Mia was like, there's certain things that are like, have their time and place. And I feel like Bob Dylan never really, and I know this hurts a lot of people, but he didn't come over to the next generation and the generation after. I agree, he's an icon, but is he one of those icons that disappeared, like the bookstore, you know? And he's just gone, man. That book has been closed. And that's why I say 50 or 60 would be great for this film. 100, I just, again, Searchlight, you're right. That's a tough sell for Searchlight too. That would be unbelievable if this film, and if it won Best Picture, I think that would be the only way it possibly could get there.
It's going to be, I mean, it opens on a Wednesday at Christmas. I think there is a world in which that 5-day opening is around $30 million. I think there's a shot.
That would be incredible if that happened.
The theater count will be an issue. I mean, Clayton, raising it that this is Searchlight. Is Searchlight actually getting this into the right amount of theaters? Is it getting any Dolbies? Is it get, you know, so that those will all be issues. You're right. If this was Warner Brothers, as much as they're bungling so many movies, they get the spend behind the movies when they need to. You know, Beetlejuice had the promotion. Yeah.
It also needs the best reviews. It needs five-star, A+. If it doesn't have that, it's in trouble. It's got to get all the reviews, man. It has to.
It has to get the reviews. This is one of the most interesting releases of the year, because it's one of those movies that could go to such extremes. And I do think there's a world in which this gets to Rocket Man, you know, $100 million or so numbers. But you're right. Maybe it's just a small Searchlight movie and the Dylan recognition isn't what we think it is. So we're all going to find out.
I just think it's Chalamet as Dylan. Like, that's the thing. If it was anybody else, I'd say who gives an S, who gives an F.
Yeah,
but this is Chalamet. This is Chalamet's Dylan. This is a generational a star, you know.
Dune, baby.
Yeah,
this Wonka. Is Dune.
Wonka.
This is Wonka. This is
Wonka. They know him. The kids know who he is. Yeah, but so, I, did you guys love Saturday Night or what?
We did love it, but we were as in the bag for that as you could possibly be. You know, I was calling that's Alan Zweibel.
Absolutely.
Before they even said his name. So
we had a whole sequel. We had sequels already mapped out in our head.
I know.
Like we had sequels in our mind. If we wanted this movie to do well enough that there could be sequels.
Yeah, we wanted that SNL 85 movie show when Dana Carvey saves the show. We wanted SNL 94 Saturday Night Dead. You know, we wanted a whole SNL universe, but don't think that's happening.
Oh God. And I love that film. I love that film, man. It was one of the best ones of the fall. And no, guess what? Nobody showed up for it, man. And that's the scary thing sometimes. Yeah.
Well, the difference is kids can still listen to like a Rolling Stone. They're not watching Bumblebees. Like it's that's the difference, is that listening to a song, it's easy to pull that up on Spotify, you know?
Yeah. And I'll tell you what, it's a different box office story if it's Chalamet's Lauren Michaels. If it's Chalamet's Lauren Michaels and that movie's opening on Christmas Day, whole different story. Mm-hmm. So, the other Christmas Day movies, I mean, Baby Girl, I'm looking forward to that. I obviously, that has a low ceiling on it, an A24 movie. about, you know, a May December romance. You know, listen, really glad this is in theaters, because this is a movie that very easily you could have seen as a Netflix release, but
yeah,
glad it'll be in movie theaters. So let's move into January now. And January is looking pretty rough to me. There's a couple of possible big hits. Let's start with January 10th, Den of Thieves 2, Pantera.
Most from Lionsgate. Most anticipated movie of January.
This how is the
sad
one.
Is that? How sad is that, though, that there's a weekend, we just totally skipping over it, January 3rd, there's no movies coming out. There is no the movies. Re-release of 7 in IMAX from Warner Brothers. They're going to re-release 7. And that's, I mean, that's cool, like, for all the Fincher fans that probably didn't get a chance to see that one on the big screen. But that's it. You guys, it's not 2020 anymore, right? Right?
Right.
We got to be releasing some crappy horror film that first week of February.
How is there not the audiences? Yeah.
Why isn't Megan 2 opening right there? You know, yeah. It's ridiculous. And so that's my beef with, they just, Hollywood's already messing, the first week of the year, they're messing it up. They are messing it up. So if 2025 doesn't go as planned, I think we all know why. You got to start out. You got to out of the gate. You got to give us the goods, man.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It wasn't the whole mantra of this past year, survive till 25. That, yeah, you know, post-strikes,
yeah,
production shutdowns, 24 was going to be rough. But, man, 25 is just going to be blockbuster after blockbuster. And then you're right. First weekend of the year, just absolutely nothing.
We're taking that off. We're taking it off. Yeah, we got nothing, guys, you know. And then it, right into Den of Thieves 2, Pantera, Lionsgate's big comeback vehicle, you know. Like, I mean, who doesn't want to see that big Gerard action on the screen? You know, I do. I want to see it. But what are we talking about? 14 million? 13?
Yeah. I mean, it's – yeah, I mean, it'll make a little bit more than something like Plane, because it's a it's a sequel to a movie that people, I think, really like. I think this is a movie that has probably played a lot on cable, you know.
Yeah.
Obviously, this is a movie Pat and I saw. We think it's better than Heat.
Yes, it's better than Heat.
I mean, this is a movie that is superior to a classic, Heat. And I saw the trailer for this, and it looks okay. I mean, I'm most anticipate, don't get me wrong, but if I'm not fully in the bag for this, then I worry about it.
Right. Although, you know, how excited were we to see Den of Thieves before we saw Den of Thieves? I mean,
but
Den
that's different. That's different. We didn't know it was a movie that was better than Heat. So now that we know that the first one's better than Heat, I'm seeing the sequel. I'm seeing the trailer for the second, and I'm thinking this maybe could be as good as Heat.
Right. Which would be a disappointment for
the
Den of Thieves movies. Yeah. Is there breakout potential in that the first one has built this following, you know, in all the years since it's been released, or is this kind of not an internet fake creation, but the type of thing that has been overhyped because we keep hearing the Bill Simmons podcast universe talk about this, and actually it's not really as big as we think it is. It's just the eight guys on that network really like the movie, and it's not broken out in a real way.
Yeah, no, it hasn't. It's R-rated. It's early January. There's great football games on. You know, it's going to be hard to get, because your core audience is watching those games. They're not going to Den of Thieves 2. They'll wait until it shows up on Netflix or whatever. This just doesn't have any drive. I mean, the whole slate of films coming out that weekend, Better Man goes into wide release. You guys saw that trailer, right? You're like, is this a fake trailer? Is this real? Mm. Is Robbie Williams really a monkey? Is this what's going on here throughout the whole film, right?
That was supposed to be an Oscar play, right? Better Man?
I know. And the audience, I think we were watching Moana 2, and it played before Moana 2, and the kids had, they laughed at the monkey and they just thought, oh, is this a cartoon? What is this? And I just think this is like Paramount's, this is, if we're talking about, you know, biopics, this may be, this may do worse than the Lego one. You know, this just looks, who's going to go see this? Please tell me who's going to go see this.
I mean, Robbie Williams really has no name recognition in the United States at this point. It's like Millennium has not carried over. You know, you were talking about, is Dylan still relevant? And that's a question mark. But he at least had like a Rolling Stone. I mean, Millennium, it does not have that same lasting power. We could agree on that, right? Robbie Williams has less recognition than Bob Dylan. Okay.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Even today. Yeah, even today. So, and so Paramount is rolling this out in a wide expansion. I mean, they should have just put it out on the third, honestly. They should have just put it on the third and see what happens. At least then you got theaters to yourself. You maybe put it in a couple IMAX screens. Who knows? And then you got a Bleecker Street film. Mike Leigh's Hard Truths comes out that week. And then The Last Showgirl, Roadside Attractions, tries to put out a wide release. This is Pamela Anderson film, the Gia Coppola film. And again, you know, that's an art house film. There's no reason to go wide with that. It's going to be a big disaster. I mean, so it's, for me, it's Den of Thieves 2 all the way. For that weekend.
I mean, there is a chance that one of the Christmas releases ends up being the number one movie that weekend. You know, it could be Mufasa. I mean, the no wide release on January 2nd, that's the type of thing that lets a movie like A Complete Unknown, if it's rolling, it'll continue to roll. December 25th, all the way through the following weekend, January 2nd, like that's where a movie like that could just...
Especially if it gets the awards clatter. But the problem is, like, didn't the Gotham, they released theirs? Did chat? I mean, I do wonder if, are we going to get a rollout where they're picking all these obscure films that nobody's seen? Is that where we're headed for the Oscars this year? Or are we going to get some films like you know, Complete Unknown and Wicked? Are they going to get nominated? You know, it's really interesting that in that box office, it's really important to these films over that time, that first, you know, that first month of the year. A lot of that award steam really comes into play when we're talking about which films get to play in cinemas because they're picking up so many awards, you know, and that's a big deal for these smaller films so they can stay in theaters week after week. It's the only way they can stay in theaters, honestly.
Here's a date I'm going to throw at you, and it's coming up this Monday. Mindy Kaling and Morris Chestnut are going to reveal the nominations for the Golden Globes this Monday, December 9th. And A Complete Unknown, I'll tell you what, I'm wearing, and if you watch us on YouTube, you get the full story. I'm wearing a hat that says box office. I will eat this hat if A Complete Unknown doesn't pick up a Best Picture nomination in the musical or comedy category. Yeah. It's not a musical, but they'll say it's a musical because there's a lot of music in it. And Chalamet is going to get a Best Actor nom.
Yeah.
Gotham Awards, you know, Boston Critics, Milwaukee Critics, all that. No, Joe Lunchpail doesn't care about that. Joe Lunchpail knows about the Golden Globes. And I think that'll be where that movie picks up a lot of steam, is it's going to get a lot of Golden Globes nominations next Monday when Morris Chestnut reads that on on television. So, so now... Here's the movie that I think could be the biggie of January. On the 17th, you got Wolfman. And Wolfman is directed by Lee Whannell, who, great director. He worked on the Saw movies. He directed Upgrade, a forgotten classic. And he made The Invisible Man, that movie that was sort of the last theatrical hit right before COVID. It came out in February of 2020. And he was able to make the Universal monster movie that worked, that was a success. And now he's got this Wolfman movie. I mean, Jeff Clayton, do you think this could be as big or bigger than what that 2020 Invisible Man was?
That's a great question, because that Invisible Man... You know, we talk about COVID and we talk about sort of movies that got kneecapped a little bit by COVID. And I feel like Invisible Man is one of those movies that I think that could have continued to do well if theaters hadn't shut down. And this is a tough one because there's no star in this. And Wolfman
Chris Abbott. There's Chris Abbott.
Okay. So that's true. For all the girls fans out there, Charlie.
Mm-hmm.
And he would hate more than anything to hear us referring to him that way, because that's why he left that show. And we don't talk about TV, of course, but we're not talking about TV. We're talking about HBO.
HBO. It's not TV.
So Charlie, one of the worst girls, except for when he's on heroin, then he's one of the best girls, could sneak into the top 10 when he's an addict. But this has Julia Garner,
who will not be playing Madonna in a biopic that was canceled.
The problem with Wolfman is that there's been several Wolfman movies that have failed.
Yeah,
like the Benicio del Toro one was what, 2010?
Yeah,
it
wasn't as long ago as you think.
The last Invisible Man movie was Hollow Man, and that was a hit, and that wasn't canon Invisible Man. But so Wolfman is going to be a hard sell, but this is a great director. So he'll do something with it. It's just whether or not people trust that name as much as we do.
Yeah. So Jeff, the Invisible Man in February 28th, 2020 opened to $28 million. Then the next weekend it did $15 million. Yeah. And then it's COVID. And I'm sure COVID kind of affected that second weekend, because that was March 6, 2020. And I think people in the know were maybe starting to get skittish. So that's a movie that made $64 million. And then COVID ends movie theaters. You know, so that movie was really on track to maybe being a $90 to $100+ million domestic hit. And I agree, that movie had a little bit more going for it. You know, Elizabeth Moss, she's got something, you know, she definitely has
a
charisma.
She's got it.
She's got it.
Well, she's got no thetans. That's the thing. It's not what she's got. It's what she doesn't have. She doesn't have the thetans, right? Because the thetans are bad.
Right. She's got the lack of thetans. She's got it. She's got that odd charisma that really compels you. And
that's what you say.
That movie, obviously, it had the hook of, you know, the female lead who's, you know, ex-boyfriend's invisible. Like there's a clear hook to that I don't know if Wolfman has able to make clear yet. But like people like wolf stuff. And well, I don't know. So Jeff, could this be that level? You know, that movie opens at $28 million. Any hope that Wolfman, just a horror movie in January, does that?
Yeah. I think it has a strong chance because, again, we're talking about such a horrible lineup of films. And this looks like a classic Blumhouse. Like you said, Lee Wannell is a great director. He's done great horror films. He has a following. And let's just talk about Julia Garner for a second. I know she's not a star yet, but man, she was so good on Ozark. And if everybody's, I'm sure, saw that on Netflix at some point. She was so good in that she was too good for Ozark. And you could tell, like, this girl has chops. She would have been in Madonna, honestly. I was excited for that. And when I saw the man, I'm going to go see this for her. I know she's not a name, but she's going to bring it for this film. My only hesitation about making this as big as Invisible Man is it's the Wolfman thing. Like, this has been done to death, man. And I do wonder, even this new generation, like, they hadn't seen an Invisible Man film. And so I think that played into one of the reasons why it was so successful. We've had we've had wolf stories on TV. We've had the Teen Wolf on MTV. So I do wonder if this is a trope that maybe we've overplayed. And that would be my only reservation about making this a big hit.
Yeah. I think the fact that it's a horror movie, and it's a horror movie that's going to get a lot of promotion behind it. And, you know, the Wolfman IP, it sort of gets you in the door, or at least gives you awareness. And then I do think we're going to see what the marketing is. How well can they sell this as, here's the big horror movie that's all by itself in the marketplace? And, you know, yeah. Horror and by Mouse default.
Blumhouse does a great job. Yeah.
So I think when you look at January this year, and last year, was that Night Swim? Was that like our January horror movie?
Yeah, that was the big letdown. I think
at the least, Wolfman is going to be so much bigger than the horror we got last January, February.
Yeah, agreed. And they probably should have opened it on the 3rd of January. That would have been great.
Yeah.
That's where Wolfman belongs.
So following week, the 24th, I mean...
Hold on. We still have September 5th on the wide expansion on the 17th as well. Paramount, Peter Sarsgaard. Honestly, guys, I think this trailer looks really good. Could it surprise and do a little bit of business, especially in this lean January month? Because it looks like a good film, like a classic 90s. It kind of reminds me of like Sneakers or something. Like it just stayed around in theaters and made some money. Like Paramount might have something here.
So September 5th is
bad title.
It's a bad title.
Terrible title. This movie will not do well because it's a terrible title. Unless you're
opening it on the date that the title is, it is only confusing.
I keep having to remind myself what this movie is about.
Yeah.
So it's on the fence as a Oscar competitor. Like there's so much it's going to do so well. And then there's other people who are like, I've never heard of this movie. What are you talking about?
Yeah.
And because September 5th is just not catchy in any way, shape or form.
Well, here's the thing. September 5th, they're like, oh, we're calling it September 5th because of what a historic event happened on September 5th. I'm sorry, but when you're talking about September dates, it's been usurped. The 5th has been usurped. So you're sort of like, September 5th, is this about what life was like 6 days before the event that we all remember from September? Is that what this is about? Because why else would you say a date in September is so famous it's the title of a movie? You know, it's been usurped.
I think it has to pick up award steam. I think you're right. If it gets some of those key nominations.
Yeah. It's also a movie about journalism with journalism as the heroes. And I think that could be a tough sell. I do think that.
What was the best picture? What was the best picture that won for that? Remember?
Oh, Spotlight.
Best picture winner. Spotlight. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's a better, we could have called this Spotlight too. That would have been great.
Yes. Try and make everything anthology. A cinematic universe. Yeah.
Yeah. Come on. Spotlight. even if it was Spotlight September 5th, then I'd at least be like, what Spotlight movie?
Yes.
Yeah.
Spotlight colon September 5th.
Yeah, this is good. Yeah. Well, we solved it for them. Paramount can still change. They can pivot.
Paramount, pivot. We're not going to charge you for this idea. We want success for the box office. Yeah, take our idea. Do. Spotlight colon September 5th.
That's a great title.
Flight Risk comes out the following week, January 24th. This is directed by Mel Gibson, starring Mark Wahlberg. It's set in an airplane. Mark Wahlberg looks like he's hamming it up as a villain. It's a Lionsgate release. Could this be the Den of Thieves that Den of Thieves 2 Pantera wanted to be? You know, could this be the crazy, you can't believe how good this is, action pick that becomes this sort of legendary, you know, we'll be talking about it on Ringer podcast for the next 10 years movie? And does that translate into actual box office when it comes out?
Well, Pat.
Yeah.
Lionsgate.
Is Lionsgate.
Yeah. So there you go. And I know it's got
Lionsgate
Wahlberg,
is a Den of Thieves.
True. But I mean, I think we're pretty low on that one, too. This does have Topher Grace, who now is known as the only decent person to be on that 70s show.
Yep. Yeah.
This might help. I mean, there's some goodwill with him.
Well, guys, I have.
Uh-oh.
I have some, this is, I'm going to spill the beans on Topher Grace. Sorry, guys. I worked on a movie when I first came to LA. Topher Grace was in it, and it was like some teen comedy. I don't even remember. My name is, some guy's name in it.
Win a Date with Ted.
Yeah, Tad Hamilton. Yeah. That's it. Tad Hamilton. So I was working in the office, and this was a low budget production, right? Mm-hmm. And Topher Grace is in it. Everybody's all excited. I'm like, oh man, Topher Grace. I love that show. Okay. I can't wait to meet him. It was so low budget that they didn't have enough computers for us in the office. So I'm like, hey, I got a computer at home. They're like, yeah, we'll rent it for $50 or, you know, whatever the rent was for a week. It's like $50 a week if you bring in your own computer. I'm like, okay, sure. I'll make an extra $50 a week. I just moved to town. I need it, man. You know, I got, you know, Tower Records stuff to buy. You know, I need that extra cash. So I bring my computer, and it's a little older, right? I mean, it's older-ish because, you know, I was just out of college, right, or whatever. And Topher Grace comes in, and I'm making coffee or something like that. Topher Grace comes in, and he wants to check something on the internet. He goes to my computer. I'll never forget this, man. Topher Grace is there going, what the fuck? How old is this computer? Yeah, I can't even get online. And he just has this like, and everybody's like, oh, Topher, come to this computer over here. Oh, this one. And I'll never forget. I'm like, Topher just dissed my computer, man, in front of everybody. You know what I mean? Wow. Like, because I got a slow computer. F you, Topher. F you, man. It was never the same after that, man. So you may say he's a nice guy, but man, I felt Topher's wrath firsthand, you guys.
Wow. So
let me recant. I'm gonna walk back.
Please.
He's the worst one of all of them.
Yeah.
Yes.
Dude.
Because totally I know you, and he was rude to you.
Yeah.
So therefore, he's the worst.
To be fair, he didn't know it was my computer, but he could have looked at my face after he said that and known, hey, oh shit, I just said this guy's computer is junk, man, in front of everybody in the office.
And Ashton Kutcher unlived somebody, supposedly.
Yeah.
So, but Topher's still the worst.
Yeah, still the worst. So yeah. I'll never see a Topher Grace film in the theater after that. Like, I couldn't even see Tad Hamilton, you know? He's this really nice guy. I was like, fuck no, dude, that's not him. He's an actor, man. And he's mean, you know, he hates computers that are slow. You know, what can you say, man? That's what we get. We get breaking reports here on the BO Boys.
Wow.
That's a story that's never been told in Hollywood.
Christopher, clip this. So WannaBO VP of Interns Christopher handles our social media. This is the clip right here. This blockbuster, never before heard story from Jeff Bock where Topher Grace dissed his computer, and there's certain lines you don't cross, and you don't talk trash about another man's computer.
Never.
That's what he did. No one on that 70s show has ever stooped as low as Topher Grace on the set of Win a Date with Tad Hamilton.
Yeah.
Wow.
Not a nice guy. Isn't he bald in this one? Is he bald or is Mark Wahlberg?
Mark Wahlberg does some crazy stuff in
he
this
does some
one,
crazy bald stuff. Yeah.
So Flight Risk has Mel Gibson, Mark Wahlberg, and Topher Grace. And Topher Grace is clearly, in real life, the worst person who has worked on Flight Risk.
Yeah,
clearly.
Absolutely. And if he's the worst, you guys, this is, you can't even play this on planes. Like, where is this going to play, man? Maybe in the red states now, maybe in Nevada it plays well.
This is a crazy rogues gallery of scoundrels in this movie.
Yeah.
It makes you then question who's this young lady in this movie and what terrible things has she done?
Yes.
Is she the worst of all of them?
Yeah.
Michelle Dockery.
Yeah. Can we get someone who's worked with her to call in or write in and maybe tell us a story about her? Because there's got to be some. It's got to be some skeletons in that closet.
Oh, there's bodies in her fridge.
Yeah.
If she's working with Mel Gibson, Mark Wahlberg, and Topher Grace, the worst of all of them.
Yeah.
So is Mark Wahlberg, is this the end for him? If you think Flight Risk is a movie that is, you know, opening in low teens or single digits and going to top out at like under 20. If that's what we're thinking on this Flight Risk movie, which I don't know if I'm there. I mean, I've got to get closer to this. I still feel like there's so much name recognition when it comes to Wahlberg and Mel Gibson. And they're going to go on the chat shows and be charming. I mean, let's long range. throwing it out there, the two January Lionsgate action releases, what does better? Den of Thieves 2 or Flight Risk? Okay.
Den of Thieves pounds it. I think single digits. Pounds I think six, 5 to 6 million opening for Flight Risk. Nobody wants to watch this film.
Wow. Clayton, any, you know, we're a month out. Are you any higher on this Flight Risk? And Flight Risk was actually supposed to come out, I think, in October.
Yeah.
Before it got pushed. Yeah.
It was. We were going to ask the young people in Washington Square Park, which you can find those videos online on all of our platforms. Very funny vertical videos at Washington Square Park, asking young people about old movie stars. One of the things we were going to ask them about was what would make them go see Flight Risk when that was still supposed to come out in the fall. Yeah. And so, yeah, this is another movie like Red One that I swear it's a Netflix movie. Like, yeah. I swear it's Netflix or Amazon. I swear it's still. And it's on the schedule, and I still swear that it is a streaming movie.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll see. I mean, maybe it's the type of movie, though, that for a certain portion of the audience, it just scratches an itch. You know, it just scratches an itch of, like, January, it's gross out, I want to be gross, and so I'll go watch this Mel Gibson, Topher Grace scumbag movie on a plane. We'll see. I mean, I'm still excited to see it, but, you know, maybe when we get a few days out. I mean, we'll see if there's any advertisement for this during football. If Lionsgate does anything during football in January to promote Flight Risk, then maybe it's got a shot. So, I mean, that seems to be it for... there is one more Friday in January. This is the 31st. And Warner Brothers has a movie called Companion, and then Universal has Dogman. So, Jeff.
Yeah. Dogman, baby. Dogman.
What do we think of Dogman?
Dogman's going to play like every other Universal film does, you know, animated film. It's going to just keep playing and playing and playing. Again, it's not as widely known as, say, you know, How to Train Your Dragon, but it plays to a much younger set. Like my brother's kids, he's got like a 4-year-old. He loves the Dogman, you know. And these are collections of books, big series of books. And it is a tradition. It's a different kind of animation style. If you see in the trailer, it plays to very young families, you can tell. Yeah. But I still think that there's potential here for Universal. I don't think it's not gonna have wild robot legs. But again, the first animated film to come out since, you know, I guess, is it Moana 2? I mean, I know Mufasa isn't technically animated, but it is, right? It is, right. But it's not technically. So again, you're a month outside of that. So the kiddies need something to go to. It's going to be Dogman. So Dogman will have a pretty decent run.
Is this a Captain Underpants situation?
Yeah. That's the comp. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that came out in 2017. Mm-hmm. And it opened to $23 million and legged out to 73 domestic. I'm shocked. Pat, I wish I would have quizzed you, because be honest,
I would have said like 17 maybe at the high
to open. And then what would the cum have been?
Oh, I would have said 55, 60. Yeah. I wouldn't have said that high. I definitely wouldn't have. And that's why Dogman will probably be right in that wheelhouse. Perfect.
Yeah. And Universal is a real studio that promotes its stuff.
Yes.
That has plenty of vehicles to promote. You know, they got a park. They've got cable channels. They've got Peacock that people actually watch. And there'll be football games on Peacock. Yeah. And then I'm sure Peacock Dogman, on the home screen will have Dogman.
Yeah. Dogman will be jumping up on there, spiking the football. You know, that's what they want. They want that crossover appeal.
Yeah, so that and yeah, it's going to be a while since there's been a you know, Sonic and Mufasa, like you said, Moana is going to be out of theaters by then or you know, in very few theaters. So Dogman, and it's got, I mean, Pete Davidson is the voice. Is he the voice of the Dogman? He's the lead voice in this, so I assume he is the Dogman. Yes, he's Orange Cat.
Who's Dogman's arch enemy?
Yeah.
Yeah. Butthole eyes, butthole cat. I mean, that's good. Yes. Casting.
So, I mean, this
any
could
chance
be,
this would, becomes a posthumous release for him?
Would that help? Would that help if it's Pete Davidson posthumously in Dogman?
No, I don't think it changed. I don't think it changes the grosses, you know, much. It's not a Crow situation where the Brandon Lee, the Brandon Lee posse just supported that one because of, wouldn't matter.
He wasn't shot on the set of Dogman.
Yeah, Dogman. He wasn't shit on. Yeah, yeah.
He lived through the production of Dogman.
Yeah, he did make it. So as far as I know, I haven't seen, he showed up. He popped up on SNL, right? He was on, what was it, when John
on
was
on the
hosting.
Mulaney episode.
Yeah, yes. Which was nice to see. I was like, there he is.
Proof of life.
There he is.
Yes.
Yeah, there he is.
Yeah.
He's back.
Yeah, you know that anytime he does a cameo on SNL, it's just proof of life. It's like, it's the equivalent of fogging up a mirror.
Yeah, it is. It's like, oh, that's nice. It's good to see him. Good for him for sticking around.
Right. They're like, if he's in the good nights, he's not in the obituary section.
Yeah.
So that's
good.
So. So let's fingers crossed that Pete Davidson is alive to promote Dogman on January 31st. Not a sure thing, but I would say, you know, he's got a shot.
Yeah.
So moving ahead to February, Love Hurts on February 7th. Is this something that could be a pre-Valentine, success?
Yes.
Now this, it's not a Valentine's movie. It's a Kiwi Kwan action movie. So this is Kiwi Kwan cashing in on winning the Oscar. And is this also Ariana DeBose? Is she also in this? Yes, Ariana DeBose. Mm-hmm. So this is two recent Oscar winners cashing in on winning the Oscar in a, you know, it's another one of these like John Wick universe of director producers trying to do that style of movie. It feels like the Bob Odenkirk Nobody.
Yeah, that's exactly what this is Nobody again, but with a new character. I mean, this looks like dumb fun, and Universal is already heavily promoting this thing. I think they think they got something here, and I kind of tend to agree with them. This might be the surprise of the Valentine season, that people might actually show up to this for not just that first week, but that second week as well. This could have, I don't know. What did Nobody end up grossing?
I mean, Nobody was like at spring 2021. So it was still heavily COVID-y, but did that get to 30? I feel like that got itself to like 28 or 30.
I can't remember. Yeah. I thought it was,
it had some drive-in help. I remember when Clayton and I were covering it then, there was a movie that it got teamed up with in drive-ins for a weekend that gave it a boost. But I think it may have got to high 20.
It,
27. 27.
Okay. 27. I would say this could get up to 40 or 50. I would love to see this at 50.
I mean, I would love, I mean, obviously, Kiwi Kwan. I mean, I don't know. There wasn't a dry eye in this house when he won his Oscar.
Yes. Yep. Yes.
It's just sad, and I know we can't really talk about Cuba Gooding Jr. anymore because he has, you know, had his things happening. But he famously said that after he won his Oscar, all the scripts he got were trash. Yeah. Like everybody said, oh, they must be coming in. I mean, Halle Berry, same thing. What does she get after she wins an Oscar? Nothing but crap. That's the problem here. Is that you look at Ariana DeBose and you look at Kiwi Kwan and they're getting crap scripts like this, whatever it is. It's just from that factory of indistinguishable, ha ha ha, funny, violent movies that these people churn out. And it's sad to see two Oscar winners have to deal with this sort of quality of script like that. That's what makes me sad personally. Now, do I hope it makes 50 to 60? Yeah, of course. I hope it's a huge hit. But it just continues this whole sort of, it doesn't matter when certain people win Oscars, it doesn't help their careers because there's just not parts for them. And that makes me sad as a moviegoer. Yeah.
Ki-Hu Kwan, though, seems to me like he's like a live-action Furby. Like, everybody just wants one of him to have in their house, you know, and squeeze and talk to. He's having like a Furby moment where I think regardless of how you feel about this script or what it is, because it's very Hollywood. It's a very Hollywood production that they don't really make often. But it feels like it's got a lot of money to it. You could see, if this was to debut on Netflix, it would look cheap. But
yes.
Universal spends some money on this. This looks like, you know, those throwbacks to the early 2000s, like when you spent a lot of money on a film like this and made it look sharp. And that's what I like about it. It's like, okay, we're throwing some bucks into the background here. It's not a cheapo Netflix piece of shit, you know?
I guess I'll have to watch the trailer again because it looks like Day Shift to me.
Yeah.
Like it that's what it looks like. I'll have to rewatch the trailer because all I got from it is like up right off the factory line of this production company.
Yeah, I think it looks better than maybe you give it credit for. Like it honestly, when I've seen it with audiences, and it's playing a lot. The trailer plays in almost every film, I feel like. They seem to enjoy it. You know, they're getting laughs at the right time. I think Universal's gonna put some weight behind this thing.
Yeah, and this is such a great test because I mean, totally agree, Clayton. It's not like Kiwi Kwan won the Oscar and then you announce he's the lead of the next Paul Thomas Anderson film. You know, he didn't get that the way certain other actors win an Oscar, and that's what they're going to get. You know, you win an Oscar and then it's the lead in a Tarantino movie. Mm-hmm. But if this thing opens, he's the top liner in an action movie, and if this thing opens in the teens, that's a huge win for Kiwi Kwan. It really shows that people recognize him, they like him, and they'll go see something. I mean, they're not going to see this because of IP or big director or the premise is super. If people go to see this, they're going to see this because, hey, I want to go see Kiwi Kwan in a real movie.
Yeah, he's very likable. And in this role, I think it's the perfect role for him where he's playing a guy who isn't who you think he is. So he'll get to play both sides of that character, right? And I know it's a trope, but for him, it works. And he's just so charming and unassuming that I feel like everybody wants him to succeed, you know, just not in just this movie, but just in Hollywood because of how long he was out of the spotlight, you know? And so this is like where, you know, audiences show him the love, you know, and maybe it happens. I don't know. I just think it's a good place for this film, honestly.
So the other movie opening that weekend, it's from Sony Pictures. I don't think this is going to be a big hit, but I do love this premise. And as soon as this is over, I'm going to see if this trailer is out. It's a horror comedy called Heart Eyes. And the premise is that there's a Heart Eyes killer, so a serial killer who kills couples. And there's two coworkers who are working late at the office, and they get mistaken for a couple by the killer, and then he's chasing after them. Love that premise. I'm sure it's one. There is a trailer. I will be watching that trailer right after we get off this double issue, 2-hour going after midnight edition of the show. I love that premise. This feels like a very small movie that I don't think has, you know, actual horror, horror movie box office potential. This feels like the type of thing that's going to be a big movie once it hits Netflix. I mean, I could be wrong. It's a horror movie opening the week before February with a romantic slant, but, you know, Screen Jeb, Sony, I think there's a low ceiling on something like this. There's no stars in it. But it's got young people, and it's a catchy premise.
I'm sure it was cheap to make. You know, Sony Extreme Gems they kind of follow the Blumhouse path, and they don't spend a lot on these. They certainly don't spend on stars. If this gets enough like TikTok hits, or you can make enough memes out of this film, it might actually do some business. Like if they do kind of a Megan style campaign where they really try to get it in social media, because I do like. I've seen the poster. I've seen some shots of it, and it's kind of clever. And I think it could work with the younger generation. If this is a PG-13, which I think it will be, they might have something here.
Well, it's co-written by Christopher Landon, son of Highway to Heaven star Michael Landon, gone too soon. He is the guy who wrote and directed the Happy Death Day movies. And if this is, and I don't know if it's going to get that level of release, but if it's in that, Happy Death Day hit the bullseye in terms of catchy premise, horror comedy, PG-13 teen audience went. I don't know if it's getting that level of release or has that level of production value, but if it hits that Happy Death Day bullseye, then maybe it is gonna do better than we're thinking this far out. Maybe it is the sort of surprise horror hit right for Valentine's Day.
I mean, he did do Freaky though. And Freaky, I mean, obviously that was a pandemic movie.
Yeah, that's October 2020. Yeah, so
but
that's,
it was a great premise. It's crazy no one thought of it before that. Mm-hmm. It was the body swap horror movie, but not a good movie. Like bad movie, like not good. So I question. And Happy Death Day to You was also not a great film. The only one of his movies that I have liked and thought was good was the first one, and that was a Scott Lobdell idea and movie that he took over. That was the writer and came up with the concept. So I'm yet to believe that this gentleman has what it takes to make a great movie. He was going to be on Scream 7. He was going to be on Scream 7, and then he begged off. So, which I think was probably a small, I think a smart move. So this Hard Eyes, it could be another like, oh, fun concept, but terrible execution.
Yeah, I think I'm just glad it's going into theaters and it's not one of those awful Netflix horror comedies where it's like, oh, the slasher went into 2004. I know I forget the name of it, but I know they.
You're
just
thinking of Netflix. The Amazon one.
Is that Amazon? I know one of those streamers. I thought it was Netflix. Just put out a movie where the premise is: what if you went back in time to 2004?
2004? Oh, maybe that is Netflix.
Yeah, yeah. I don't. Jeff knows what I'm talking about here.
Yeah, I know what you're talking. And I watched the trailer. And I said, nope, that's not for me.
Yeah. So at least this isn't that. Glad to see it's in theaters. I'm excited to, again, watch the trailer for this right after we get off the call here. So that's February 7th. All right, now let's go to February 14th. Valentine's Day weekend.
Here's
the biggie. Here's the one that could be the only winter movie that gives Mufasa a run for its money. Or it could be flop of the year, February 14th, from Marvel, from Disney, Captain America, Brave New World, Anthony Mackie taking the shield. He's Captain America, sort of. It's a troubled production.
Yeah.
I mean, every big movie has reshoots, but I feel like the reworking of this Captain America movie has been year after year.
All you need to know?
Give it to us, Clayton.
Paddington 3 moved to take on Captain America.
Wow.
That movie moved. Yeah. It said, I'm not afraid of you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I will take you down.
Yeah. You move away from Marvel films traditionally. Clayton is right. So even Sony, who is kind of a Marvel partner, said, F you guys, you don't got the goods. We're bringing in Paddington because that's what the people want.
Now, Paddington is a brave little bear. Obviously, he's going off to Peru. Yeah. But 2018, 2017, 2019, he ain't taking on Marvel. Right?
No, he's right.
He's not stepping up and saying, here we go. I'm gonna be eating marmalade and that's enough. You know, like that speaks volumes that this thing is DOA. I don't care about Red Hulk. I don't care about anything. This movie is DOA. No one cares.
Clayton's right in a sense. Clayton is right. This feels like a continuation of the bad things that Marvel was doing, you know, before they said, oh, what people really want is Deadpool and Wolverine. That's what they really want. That kind of style and that kind of flash. Brave New World feels like a continuation of the bad films that Marvel was making that just didn't really resonate with the audiences. It wasn't what the audiences actually wanted. And this is in that old world that we're kind of done with. We want new Marvel. We want Blade. Right. We want the X-Men. We want Fantastic Four. There are certain things that we want. And this is not even Captain America that we know. Nothing against Anthony Mackie. I think he's great. But this is a this feels like a D plus. This is a Disney Plus movie. That's what it feels like to me, even watching the trailer. So it's going to do better than the Marvels, but don't expect it to. You know, it's you know, if it does 200 million domestic, that would be okay. And that's sad for a Marvel film, and they know that. So this is going to be really interesting to watch what this thing could open to.
And Jeff's a nice guy, but something against Anthony Mackie. He's not a star in any shape or form. He is not a guy that anybody has ever paid to see. That no one has ever said Anthony Mackie's in that. I'm paying to see that.
You could watch him for free on Peacock, right? And nobody watched Twisted Metal.
Yeah, Anthony Mackie's family. I don't know. Yeah. I don't know. I mean, his aunts and uncles, his mom, his dad, his sisters, his brothers, the other people in his family. They pay, but nobody else. That it doesn't have Mackie as the last name. Yeah.
No, you're right, Clayton. Absolutely right. And Harrison Ford isn't a draw anymore in the theaters. So where is the draw for this film? It's not there. There's not enough Avengers in this. This is not a Captain America movie that was like a little Avengers film. This is not that. This is something very D plus. And when it gets that D plus stank on it, same as Thunderbolts asterisk feels like a D plus stank. You know, Disney and Marvel's going to have a tough time with those two, and hopefully Fantastic Four reboots the system. You know, that's all I can say about what Marvel has this year. It's not looking great.
This is a problem, though, I'm going to agree. I think this movie is going to tank by Marvel standards. I mean, I do think opening weekend, the Marvels in November of 2023 opened to $46 million. I don't know if Brave New World does significantly better than that. I don't know. I think it will have a better run. I mean, my God, reliving the Marvels box office run, it opened to $46 million. The second weekend, it made $10 million. That still blows me away looking at that. That movie dropped from $46 to $10 million. So I don't think Brave New World's going to have that run. The Marvels is such a unique in the context of when it came out, what a disaster the movie was. But I don't know if it opens much better than that. You know, I don't know if I don't think Brave New World is going to open to $90 million. It's going to be.
I can see 50 65 or 60. Is a good number for that film because we haven't seen a block by the time we hit the 14th, which is Valentine's Day, people are going to go. They love to go see movies. And guess what? If you're not going to most people are not going to Paddington in Peru as a date movie. You're probably going de facto. It's just a Marvel film. Yeah, let's go to that. And that's probably what will pump it up a bit over that week, because it is also President's Day weekend. You got the Monday holiday. And it's, guess what? It's the only blockbuster opening in the winter after these December films. It's the only big presence. It's going to have all the support. And that's why it's not too big to fail, because you're right. It will fail by Marvel standards, but by other films that are in the marketplace, it's the best thing they got in February, because there ain't a lot there. You guys know this.
But don't sleep on that bear. Here's the thing about Paddington is that these movies are, you know, there's kids who were raised on these movies, who watched these movies growing up, that are now going to be old enough to go on their teenage first Valentine's Day dates. And they may want something comforting like, oh, at the very least, I have this vestige of my childhood in case I get nervous, or, you know, like, I just want something that feels comforting, because this is a brave new world of romance that I'm entering as a teenager.
Yeah. So you're saying people in the back row are going to get busy to Paddington, while the people in the front row are just going to enjoy it for the bear that he is.
Go there and do whatever.
Whatever.
Kids go to dark theaters together to do whatever.
Whatever. Okay. They go see Paddington 3, and someone says, is that a marmalade sandwich in your pocket? And he, it's, yeah.
the fuzzies will show up. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't think the other two Paddington movies did that well in theaters, right? At least domestically, right?
Well, that's the thing. These Paddington movies are very much an international play. The first one in 2015 opened to 18 in the States, did 76 domestic, but did 250 worldwide. Paddington 2 did worse domestically in 2018. It only ended up at 40 million domestic, but did 241 worldwide. So they are consistent, but domestically they are very much a critical and streaming situation. U.S. audiences are not going to see these Paddington movies.
Paddington already opened, right?
Already opened
internationally.
Paddington, but people have, kids have watched these at home, and that's where I feel like this generation is going to be. This is going to be the first one they get to see as like independent, you know, teenagers. They're going to get to see this movie in theaters,
and the second one is the classic.
Do you guys know the Paddington lore? Like in the books, was Peru a big destination for him? Because it's like it seems to me to be so obscure that like if you said, you know, he was going to France or, you know, a country that a lot of people go and visit, you know, the Maldives, Paddington in the Maldives, you know, but Peru, like did they get in on the financing on this and say, hey, we need people to come to Peru. This is our play. It's a P, Paddington, Peru. That makes sense. But how did this happen? How did he go here?
Peru as a location does not feel like a value add. Listen, obviously we're biased, but it is true that if you wanted to make a box office play, and especially to break Paddington in the United States, it's Paddington 3 Bear in New York City. That's the move if you want this to be a box office hit in the United States and worldwide. You get this bear on the Empire State Building. Yeah. You get the bear in Citi Field. You get the bear in Madison Square Garden. But Peru is not New York City.
Yeah, you might be biased because you do love and live in New York.
Greatest city in the world.
It would be great. Yeah, but even Paddington in Paris would say Americans would go, oh yeah, I want to see this bear, you know, climb the Eiffel Tower. That sounds fun. I mean, it just like when I get the image of, when you say the word Peru and the, I'm sorry, I don't have any images in my mind really. Like, what is he doing in Peru? What is in Peru? What can we do? And I don't want to offend anybody from Peru.
It's great. I think
the marketing from Peru needs to be better. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know what's going on there.
Yeah. You know, or Bear in Madrid, something
that. Yeah, I know what's going on there.
Yeah, I agree. I don't see how Peru, because Paddington 2 is the not the breakout box office wise, but that is the classic. That's the one that everyone says, this the best movie ever?
Ever.
So part 3 was a very important play because this is the first one to come out after the classic, after 2. And Peru doesn't feel like the big value
add.
It's
just not big enough.
It's not, you know, and it's not a new star. You know, you're not adding, Brad Pitt is going to hang out with Paddington in Peru. It's basically cool. Peru is the value add, and it doesn't feel like that's enough to break this out. Definitely not in the States. So I love that Paddington went up against Captain America, and that's a ballsy move from this bear. But I wish Paddington was bringing something to the fight more than I'm going to be in Peru.
I'll be in Peru. Catch me there.
Yeah.
Bro.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yo, I think he's just like cocky. I mean, I just think he's cocky as hell. He's like, I don't even need to be in America. I could be in Peru.
I could be in Peru and I'll still fuck
the
shit up.
It's a cool move. It is. It's a baller move. It's a baller move. You can't deny it.
Yeah. Yeah, do we get, and I know this isn't Paddington's image, but do we get the classic Calvin and Hobbes, Paddington pissing on the shield as a last minute poster for Paddington 3 before it opens?
Here, can I just have some runway here?
Yeah, go for it. Cook.
Please, are wannabeo boys, wannabeo girls, wannabeo people. I know there's so many great artists out there. I know there's so many talented individuals. please, I'm begging you, draw this image of Paddington a la Calvin pissing on the Captain America shield.
Yeah, open in the raincoat.
And please, 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 please email us.
Yeah.
At theboboyspodcast@gmail.com. Yeah. And we'll put it all over our socials. We'll give you credit. I mean, if there's several, we will create a slideshow.
Yeah.
Please, I beg of you. I want to see this image more than any image other than me drinking from that water bottle, which is a great holy image that is going to be on T-shirts.
Yeah.
The famous frozen screen. But yes, please, please, please illustrate this and send it to us.
Yeah.
Guys, maybe this is so good that maybe we should just go on Fiverr and spend $25 and get it done. You know what I mean?
You know,
we could go on Fiverr.
Let's let the fans see what they could do first. Okay. But then that is an option, is to actually pay for someone to do it. And here's the other part of that image in the background. This is the Easter egg. So you've got Paddington raincoat open, pissing on the shield. Famous Calvin and Hobbes image is recreated by Paddington. And deep in the background, you see Dwayne The Rock Johnson with a Voss water bottle. And he's walking over because he wants to fill the water bottle.
He loves that piss bottle. Yeah.
He loves a piss bottle and he's empty. So he's like, let me get some Paddington juice. So that is the drawing. We'll have a contest if we get multiple images. Who draws the best Paddington pissing on the shield a la Calvin and Hobbes? theboboyspodcast@gmail.com. Let's get that contest going and release it all opening weekend of Brave New World versus Paddington 3 Paddington in Peru. So, yeah, I mean, that's the thing is Brave New World, if you're a movie theater, you're praying that this is not part of the Marvel decline, because you do need this. When you look at that January slate where we're hoping Wolfman breaks out or multiple Lionsgate, you know, action movies, and we're saying, oh, maybe Love Hurts, you know, Kiwi Kwan is number one at the box office one weekend. These theaters do need Brave New World to not be of the Marvels.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, they do. And they're going to be hurting at that time when we see what's coming out in January. Dogman can only do so much on his own. You know, he needs help.
Yeah. Yeah. So as much as we do think these superhero movies, other than the big IP characters, are really in trouble, I don't want to see Brave New World do the Marvel's numbers, because that's the type of thing that, God, theaters are shuddering if, you know, January and February are this empty. But who knows? I mean, Mufasa and these Christmas releases just got to play like crazy for a month.
Yeah. Yeah, they do.
And you know, again, back to it, this is where a complete unknown could really just keep eating and eating. It's just like, man, I guess January weekend four of Complete Unknown, it's still making in the teens.
Or Robbie Williams. Or Better Man might be the one. You know, we might just totally miss this, and it's not Bob Dylan, it's Robbie Williams.
It's Robbie Williams.
Who's making that cash with that sweet monkey.
100%. Well, speaking of monkeys, February 21st, The Monkey from Neon. This is Osgood Perkins directed another movie. So Long Legs, director Osgood Perkins, turning it around quick with The Monkey. You know, horror always wins. That is what Brett of The New Flesh always says, that horror always wins. So could The Monkey really coast off of the everyone loved Long Legs? It was a big summer hit. Don't know what this monkey, The Monkey, is going to be at all, but is it enough just to say the new movie from Osgood Perkins?
It might be. It's also Stephen King adaptation, right, of a short story.
Yeah.
But that's not actually a box office calling card. We know how those films usually go. And Stephen King, it's weird because he's not really a huge box office draw. You know, his films do okay, but they don't usually slay. And so I do wonder how Neon is going to approach this one. Do they even mention that? Or do they probably will just lean heavily on Osgood Perkins. This is Theo James. I don't think people really know him. Isn't Elijah Wood in this as well?
Elijah Wood is third build in this.
Oh, for me, that's a set. That's a yes. Absolutely. Yep. I will go see Elijah Wood in this. But again, it's going to depend on that like market. I think Neon's going to pretend like this is an independent film like Long Legs. And it's just, it's really gritty and dirty. But I honestly, I don't know what this, I haven't seen anything except I did see a big standee in the theater. And I was like, well, okay, Neon is getting ready. If they're putting that in, it was in November. So they're pretty high on this, as they should be. This could be Neon's big play. You know, yeah. this is good for them.
And Long Legs was Neon, right?
Yes.
Yeah, it was. It was.
So this is their guy. I mean, this is their signature filmmaker. That was, I think, probably the biggest hit Neon ever had.
I think it is.
So they definitely want this, the monkey, to work. And that monkey image is, it's a good one.
It's better than Better Man, for sure. They got the monkey in the right context, I think.
Yes. Yes. Scary monkey is the way to go.
Now, to all our wannabe-o boys, wannabe-o girls, wannabe-o people.
People.
Could we also have somebody draw the monkey from the monkey pissing on the Robbie Williams monkey?
A golden shower
would be really nice.
Yeah, yes. The Robbie Williams monkey's liking it.
He likes
yeah.
it.
Yeah, yeah. He loves that. Yeah, are he you loves kidding? It.
That's this great. Was this was consensual.
Yes,
yeah, absolutely.
Monkey piss play. Yes.
Yeah, yeah. And a bad monkey like the monkey would do that. He just would. Osgood Perkins monkey would piss on just about anybody, probably.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's why you love him, and that's why people might go see this in the theater. Man, I think this could be. It's James Wan produced it.
Yeah,
there's a lot going for it. The Stephen King thing is on the poster. I mean, Stephen King is just such a no brainer. You got to put him on there if he's part of it.
But you don't have to lean on it, and I don't think they will, because it has so much other stuff working for it, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I'm excited. I'm excited for this to come out, because if this is a hit, then Osgood Perkins really gets to be in that tier of a name filmmaker.
Yeah.
You know, he's what you put above the title. You don't have to worry about a movie star. You just, the director's the star.
Well, and how do we know any other Osgoods since the 1700s? Like, that's, you're bringing the name back too, which I respect, you know?
Right, right.
Oh, Osgood. That sounds like, I'm going to name my kid Osgood. That's a good name.
Yeah.
I like it.
I think people just go with Oz or Ozzy and get away from the Osgood because, is Ozzy Osbourne's real name Osgood Osbourne? Osgood? Do we know that? I'm gonna look that up right now. If
it's important, for box office. We have to understand the minutia. We go very deep here, you know.
So
you
guys always have one. It is John Michael Osborne. Ozzy is just a nickname. He was not born Osgood Osborne. So that's
Perkins,
a disappointment.
Osgood Perkins is really trying to bring it back on his own.
Yeah, yeah. So there's a lot riding on this. The monkey. I mean, coming after Brave New World, it could be an underwhelming opening weekend, and then the monkey could slide in there and do business that's comparable to Brave New World's second weekend. We'll see.
We know it's not Zachary Levi and the Unbreakable Boy from Lionsgate that also opens that weekend. That film was supposed to come out, I think, in 2019, right?
Unbreakable Boy with Zachary Levi. So is this the swan song of Zachary Levi? You know, is this the last time we get a chance to see this man in a movie theater?
It's got to be, right? The Purple Crayon, man. Everybody said, no, I am not doing Purple Crayon, man. And Purple Crayon had a big following. So it was more people just said, hey, I'm not seeing Zachary Levi than say, I really want to see that Purple Crayon. They might have to reboot it without Zachary Levi because I think it'll work.
Mm-hmm. I agree. I think that Purple Crayon didn't get a fair shake because
it didn't.
Of Zachary Levi's presence. Yeah. Yeah, so Unbreakable Boy, is he playing a kid again? Is this another one where Zachary Levi switches,
no.
does a big thing? No, he's not doing this.
No, there's a different boy.
He's a father, it looks like, whose son has brittle bone disease. Doesn't feel like a big box office hit. I'm assuming there's probably some kind of religious aspect to this.
They're going to have to find one. They're going to have to find one. Otherwise, 4 million opening, you know?
Yeah.
Well, this is the same person behind Ordinary Angels. He was the director, okay. and he was the screenwriter okay. of Jesus Revolution.
Okay. Oh, so there will be
and screenwriter of American Underdog.
Okay.
Okay. So faith-based play. Okay.
This movie wrapped filming in late 2020. So this movie has been on the shelf since before.
There's always a reason. There's always a reason it's sitting on the shelf, right? Have you ever heard of a film that sat on the shelf for 5 years and was it just a big hit? Have we ever heard of that? Ever?
Yeah, you don't usually get a movie dusted off the shelf and then it opens to $30 million. That hasn't happened yet. But then again, we still have not had the theatrical release of The Day the Clown Cried.
And mm-hmm.
that could be the one. You put that out in theaters and it opens to $30 million. So,
I mean, this Unbreakable Boy is now an unbreakable man.
Yeah. He is. Absolutely is.
That's true. The actor who plays the Unbreakable Boy is...
He can't do press. He can't do the press. Or he actually died already, too.
Well, you know what? We will stop because the actor who played him... I don't know if the actor who played him has brittle bones. So he might
be... Okay, I was hoping not. I hope they didn't take a real boy, yeah. And that would be horrible. But it was a chance. Because Lionsgate will do anything for a hit these days, you know? They need
I believe it's Jacob Laval, and he seems to be alive and well.
Yeah. He's been
But he's doing teen romances now, probably, right?
He does not look like a boy.
Yes, okay. He is a man now.
He's a young man. Okay, good. Good for him. Way to grow up.
This is like back in COVID times when Clayton and I talked a lot about the shelved Ghostbusters Afterlife movie and how if they shelved it for too long that those kids would be unable to promote it because they would be way too old. And Unbreakable Boy said, "You ain't seen nothing yet. We're shelving a movie starring a child for 5 years.
Yeah. Hold my beer until this movie comes out because then I can legally drink it."
Yep.
Guys, it'd be probably more profitable for Lionsgate if they just never released it and it became like a cult thing. I mean, honestly, why release it at this point? Like, just let it sit, let it marinate for another 10, 15 years. Because that'd be a great story. You know?
Put it in the vault with Acme versus Coyote.
Yes.
With Glitterati, with The Day the Clown Cried, with Batgirl. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Let it sit, let it soak. You know, let it soak for maybe 100 years. Put it in a time capsule. Has a film ever been put in a time capsule and then said, "Hey, you guys, you will never see this, but 100 years later, your relatives will get to see it." That's pretty cool.
Played at the Unbreakable Boy's funeral, And listen, I want Jacob Laval to have a long life.
Yeah,
I mean, the longer his life is, the more interesting this release will be.
That is the gimmick, is the film will be released the day after Jacob Laval's death, which we hope is
and we want him,
at like 120. Him to live set the record.
Mm-hmm. We want him to live to 100. And then at the funeral, it's the first screening of this film. How great is that? His grandkids get to watch it. You know, how great is that? And the world gets and it becomes this huge viral hit. That's the best case scenario for this film right now.
Yes, his funeral takes place at AMC's in 100 years.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. That is the way they should go. They should pull this off the schedule from February 21st and date it as upon the death of the lead child actor, we will release the Unbreakable Boy. And I'd love to see Zachary Levi's social media hissy fit when they make that announcement.
Yeah, he'll be upset.
Yeah.
Actually, it'll do him good because he doesn't need a $3 million opening, another $3 million opening. You know,
no.
This might actually help his career by not releasing it.
So yeah, the Unbreakable Boy. Now I'm excited about this, but just only if they don't release it. Then I will be excited. And then now looking at this last weekend in February 28th, tell me if any of this strikes even a note of recognition for you. It is Last Breath from Focus, The Legend of Ochi from A24, My Dead Friend Zoe from our friends at Briarcliff Entertainment, and Vicious from Paramount Pictures. Jeff, any notes on any of those?
This is the biggest shit show since December 6th, 2024, I would say. Like in terms of just a massive amount of really crappy films that probably don't belong in theaters at all and will be totally forgotten by March 7th, you know, when Sinners takes over the world. Ryan Coogler's new film. This is the dead zone of dead zones. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's opening on, these are all on leap day, right? It's a leap day year, right? In 2025.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So then these movies,
these films
kind
shouldn't
of
even
exist.
Yeah. They don't exist. They should be, they should just put away for 4 years. And most of these films will be like, none of those films speak to anybody. I saw the trailer for Last Breath with Woody Harrelson, and he's under the water and like, we got to save a buddy who's trapped down there, but there's no sharks. I'm like, wait, where are the sharks?
Mm-hmm.
They're underwater. It's Woody Harrelson. We need sharks. And it's not, sharks. It's just, we need oxygen, you know, and that's all that this is Last Breath, you know? And I saw it. I'm like, nope, that's Focus Features. A24. If you've seen the trailer for Legend of Ochi, it reminds you of a really bad 80s film that saw Batteries Not Included and said, oh, we got to make one of our own Batteries Not Included. You know, Legend of Ochi is a really weird turn for A24. I don't know how this film even exists. Huh. Honestly, it's like Mac and Me. It probably shouldn't exist, you know, but it does. That's what
Could
Legend
this
of
be
Ochi
the new Mac like. And Me. I'm looking at the poster for this and it's a monkey like creature there.
Yeah. I don't know. What was the one that there was another film that came out? The company doesn't even exist anymore. They put a film out that's kind of like this too. I can't even remember the title. When I saw it, I'm like, ooh, this is bad BO all the way. And then Vicious, I don't know. Like that is a horror film from Paramount. Hopefully it's their next smile. Like but it opens the week after Monkey. So it's going to be up against it, I think, because we all agree Monkey is going to be very interesting, I think, to audiences. The only other thing that I heard on this weekend that actually perked up my box office radar, and I don't even think it's on the numbers, but we have it at ERC. The Ketchup Entertainment film, The Day the Earth Blew Up, the Looney Tunes movie, is supposed to come out the 28th.
Okay.
So Daffy Duck and Porky Pig, this thing. This was rescued, you know, from going maybe to a vault. I don't know what Warner Brothers was planning to do with this, but they sold this one to Ketchup Entertainment. And Ketchup Entertainment, as we know, barely releases films. But they're going to have a Looney Tunes movie. That's kind of cool to me.
Yeah. It doesn't speak, though, highly of this movie that Warner Brothers was like, we could allow this to go to Ketchup Entertainment.
But we can't let Coyote versus Acme.
Though here's the thing. Maybe if Ketchup Entertainment does well with this release, maybe then they will get Coyote versus Acme, where Warner Brothers says, Ketchup Entertainment, they get our Looney Tunes characters better than we do.
They are the new Warner Brothers for Looney Tunes. Because, look, that is an IP that Warner Brothers is just freaking wasting.
Yeah.
It is. It's bigger than anything Universal used to have. And Universal created all these, you know, they got the DreamWorks, they got the Illumination, the Minions. Guess what? Before all that, Warner Brothers had all that shit, but they haven't been able to capitalize on it. And now they're leasing it out to one of the worst distributors in the world. Like, what is going on with Warner Brothers?
How could you make no money on Bugs Bunny? How is that possible?
I don't know. Marvin the Martian should be as big as the Minions, for God's sakes. That character is amazing.
Yeah.
Like, we should, honestly, we should get a group of people together and just take over Looney Tunes at Warner Bros. Like, just, I mean, just go out there. It, just pit torches, pitchforks, take it over by force. Yeah.
Well, the move might be to get a conglomeration together and buy Ketchup Entertainment, and that's our backdoor way of controlling Bugs Bunny.
Yeah, I like it, man.
Yeah, well, that's the move.
Man, I'm shocked that the Looney Tunes fall from grace, because I could see this happening with maybe the Muppets.
Yeah.
You know, like, mm-hmm. I could see Disney leasing the Muppets out to Ketchup Entertainment, because the Muppets are pointless at this point. It's, you know, they might as well be used for rags to wax the cars of these executives.
Yeah, there are no tiny puppets.
I mean my thing with that was that, you know, Disney, when they start buying movie theaters, they need to have these Muppets working these theaters. I mean, Kermit should be ripping your ticket, and the Eagle should be cleaning the toilets. And I think that would be a great value for their investment, because who wouldn't want to go to a theater where you could see like, you know, Miss Piggy, you know, giving you popcorn and shelling out nachos for you.
Yeah.
And those two old dudes, the Siskel and Ebert like guys, just talking about the films afterwards, you know?
I mean,
it's a great play for Disney, and you're right, Clayton. I think the fact that Disney doesn't have their own theaters now is a crime. You know, it really is. El Capitan, this is downtown Hollywood. They have the El Capitan Theater, and it plays all Disney movies, and Disney owns it, but they don't think of great stuff like that. Like, why not have the Muppets run it for an entire month just to see what happens, you know?
Yeah.
It would be great. But the fact that that's not a thing yet, that the El Capitan isn't really Disneyized, even though it's a Disney's own theater, this should be just something that happens in all the major metropolitan areas around. Muppets working them, the Marvel characters working them. Are you kidding me? Like, who wouldn't want to see that? You know?
Yeah, they should have the electric teeth playing a live score to like the cabinet of Dr. Caligari or whatever. Like, why not do that?
Yeah.
I'd go see that shit.
Yeah. A lot of people would, you know? It is a crime that Warner Brothers has treated Looney Tunes like trash, honestly. Like, they just, there's such a collection of characters. And I mean, this one stars Porky Pig and Daffy Duck. And let's be honest, Porky Pig's like D-list. He's D-list, and he's getting into theaters, but Coyote can't get in theaters. Mm-hmm. You're kidding me.
Well, Porky's got to go on Ozempic.
Yeah, he does. He does.
Yeah.
And Daffy, I think, if I'm not mistaken, Daffy might have been racist. He said a lot of mean things back in the day, Daffy did. And so maybe this is his, like, you know, he's got to redeem himself.
Mea culpa,
you know?
Mea culpa, mea culpa.
Yeah,
mea
culpa.
I mean, this is the time where maybe, you know, Daffy's like, hey, it's free speech time. Let me be Daffy.
Yeah, so, let me say what I got to say.
Let me say what I got to say. And this
is Pepe Le Pew got me too'd.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he did. Yeah, Pepe. Yeah. Pepe was, But yeah, Pepe was doing some weird shit. He was like, it was like some Cosby shit, you know, what Pepe was doing.
Oh, yeah. There was the numbers were too many for Pepe.
Yeah,
So anything else that we didn't cover in these couple of months here that you feel like, oh, this could be a breakout? I mean, I mean, Jeff, of all the movies we mentioned, you know, the non-Mufasa, non-Brave New World, would, you know, and taking out the Dylan movie, because I think we all think it'll do well, you know, the ceiling is different, but is there anything that you feel like this is the potential breakout, you know, of everything we mentioned? Is there anything that, like, man, this could do way bigger than people are giving it credit for? Is it Love Hurts? Do you think Love Hurts?
Love Hurts would be mine.
80 million.
Yeah, Love Hurts is one that I think, but the other one obviously is Dog Man. Maybe the kids love him so much. We're not talking about 70 million. We're talking about 130 or 150 million. Mm-hmm. And that'd be huge for that Dog Man. And I wouldn't put it past Universal, because they seemed better than anybody else. They seem to can work these original films, and they just stick around in theaters for a long time, man. Mm-hmm. And they kind of have their way with, with younger families in a way that, you know, maybe Disney doesn't as much. You know, they kind of want to appeal to everyone, and Universal kind of has their eye on, you know, different demos inside of that family marketplace. So it's kind of interesting, but for the most part, it's a goddamn shit show, and it's theaters are going to struggle in January and February. I hope that there's breakouts, because they really need them. We covered almost all of these films, and we were all like, I don't know. There's nothing that says massive breakout potential. And that's kind of scary for the industry when we're supposed to be going back to the normal. We're supposed to be going back to 2019, right? When everything was hunky dory. And when you don't open a movie on January 3rd, you're just setting yourself up for being slapped in the face. So there's still time. We can pivot, right? We have a month, right? We can pretend like it's the pandemic again, and let's just put a film in there real quick, right? Paramount can put Vicious in there and everybody would be fine with that, right?
Right.
We don't need a buildup. We just need a horror movie to start out the new year, you know?
Quickly, can I throw something out there? Because I know we're over 2 hours, which was our target.
Yes.
February 13th, a movie drops on Peacock. Bridget Jones, Mad About the Boy.
Yeah.
Renee Zellweger, Hugh Grant, Emma Thompson, Colin Firth.
Wow.
Why is this skewing theaters?
So it's dropping it domestically in the United States. It's Peacock. Everywhere else, it is theatrical. It is an international theatrical play. And I think that is just at this point where they see the Bridget Jones franchise. Yeah. This is going to clean up in the theaters in the UK and the rest of Europe. And they, for whatever reason, think that they'll get more value out of it in the States by not promoting it theatrically, not spending that, and just putting it on Peacock.
You don't think this could make a $10 million opening in America?
You know, I guess they're doing the math and they're like, we'd rather just not have to market theatrically.
Yeah.
Because it's going to make all its theatrical money overseas. And
I guess, like you said, Universal is pulling for this Love Hurts to be the new thing. And so you got to steer clear of it, because we're really putting all our money into Love Hurts. And that's what it felt like to me, because we had it on the schedule for a little while because we heard it was coming out. And then the Peacock says, that's not coming out, guys. Not here anyways. And so I was surprised, and that just happened like a month ago. I was surprised that they totally took it off too, Clayton. I was like, you couldn't have found another place for this thing? It didn't have to be Valentine's.
Paddington. I mean, you're putting Paddington in theaters. I mean,
yeah. I know.
Listen, I guess somebody draw Paddington pissing on Bridget Jones.
Yeah. Well, maybe the melting faces. Hugh Grant's face is melting a little bit, and maybe that was too scary for them. You know, maybe they're like, we can't market this. We can market him in Heretic. You know, we can market him in a horror film, but I don't know if we can get those two kissing and make it seem that people want to see. Something it's too horrific for some people, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And Universal, God bless them. They're keeping the lights on for these theaters in January and February. You know, they're putting out Wolfman. They're putting out Dogman. They're putting out, they have a big movie in February.
Love Hurts.
So they're of the big studios, at least putting product out there. So it's, you can't rake them over the coals for not putting Bridget Jones in theaters domestically.
I'm not raking them over the coals. I'm just saying, I want to see a movie like that go theatrical, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. At least do the day and date and don't even promote it that much.
Yeah. Day and date. That's fine.
Fine. People are used to that now. Give them the choice, give them the opportunity on a special Valentine's Day exclusive, one day only you could go see this, or one weekend only. That seems like a good play, Clayton. I agree. Why can't we do it for 3 days, day and date? People would show up.
The weekend.
Yeah. Just the weekend, baby.
Yeah. That is January and February. And it's rough stuff. And I guess survive till spring 25. Is that the mantra?
Survive that needs to be the mantra. That's the
survive
new,
till
the
spring
new mantra,
25.
Yeah. And that's when it gets us to Snow White. And we'll see how Disney is faring, you know. See if Disney can pull a rabbit out of the hat with that one, you know?
Yeah.
That'll be interesting.
Yeah, because I mean, we're obviously not going in it. That'll be in the spring preview. But just quickly looking at March, man, it doesn't look that much better.
So it might be survive until summer 25?
It's basically survive until Minecraft movie 25 in April. Yeah. That, I guess, is the mantra we'll go with. So anyway, that is your winter preview. The most important thing is, as bereft of huge hits as those months seem to be, we just did over 2 hours on it, which means that this show was not going to have any trouble covering theaters.
Absolutely not.
There's no bumpy roads ahead for the BO Boys or for Jeff Bock of Exhibitorations Co. So, Jeff, where can the Wanna BO Boys, Wanna BO Girls, Wanna BO people find your coverage, find your work?
Guys, this is kind of another big announcement, not as big as Topher Grace dissing my computer, but I used to only be exclusive on Twitter or X, but now, guys, I just signed up for Blue Sky a couple weeks ago, baby. So you can hit me up on Blue Sky now too. And I'm much nicer on Blue Sky because the atmosphere is just, it's kind of a relief to be there. There's just not this heavy handed, there's not people punching you in the nuts. You know, it's just, it's kind of a nice place to be. And so, and thus everybody who responds on there, I'm very like happy go lucky. And just, so if you want a cool, you know, guy that you want to respond to, go on the Blue Sky and check it out, man. I'm just saying, you know, if you hit me on Twitter, I could be a dick to you. That's just kind of how Twitter is. You guys know it.
Yeah, you got to fight dirty on Twitter.
You got to fight dirty. Yeah.
And don't come at you on Truth Social.
Oh, no, don't do that. No, don't do that. Yeah, yeah. Not there yet. But again, you know, we'll see. So yeah, hit me up on Blue Sky or hit me up on Twitter and I'll hit you back. But either way, it's fun.
Amazing. And is it ERC box office on Blue Sky?
I think it's something like that. Yeah, something I don't like know.
That. You'll find
it. Yeah, it's so new that I don't even know. Yeah. But it is, I don't know if you guys joined Blue Sky, but it honestly is, it's like the old Twitter. It really is. It's like even the way it works and stuff, you're like, oh yeah, I remember this. This was cool. Yeah. Oh, there's the people that I follow are actually the people that are on. Oh, that's cool. You know? So it's a concept. You know, it's something that, yeah, it's a great concept.
All right, so we're gonna have.
Yeah.
Wannabe OVP of interns, Christopher, start looking into it. You know, he'll do the research. Yeah. He'll come back to us with a full PowerPoint presentation, take us through what this Blue Sky is about, and possibly the BO Boys will join Jeff Bock, Exhibit Relations Co. over there. Of course, in the meantime, email us. theboboyspodcast@gmail.com. Send us those images of it's going to be who's pissing on who. Oh, it's Paddington pissing on the shield.
Shield.
On Captain America's shield.
That's the most important one. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the big one.
And guys, fuck Topher Grace. Maybe we could get someone pissing on him too. I don't know. Just a thought.
I love that. Let's also get Topher Grace in the mix. So we've got.
Let's get. What model was your computer? Jeff, the old computer, because my concept would be that it is a laptop, an outdated laptop, pissing on Topher Grace.
I love that. So it's Jeff's old computer pissing on Topher Grace.
Yeah, it's one of those old Color Macs. You know those ones that have the funky colors? Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, a Color Mac pissing on Topher Grace. God, you guys got a lot of work to do. You can split it up. I would say what everybody should do is just create an email chain where you grab an image and say, this is what I'm going to illustrate. Just like this amongst yourself as fans, reach out to each other.
Yeah. Here's a tip. Here's a shortcut for you. You could reuse the same drawing of the stream across the different images. So, you know, it's going to be this color, Mac pissing on Topher Grace. It's going to be Paddington pissing on the Captain America shield with the rock deep in the background with a Voss water bottle. And it's going to be the monkey from the monkey pissing on the
monkey from Robbie Williams.
Robbie Williams. Yeah.
Yes. Monkey. So, but you could draw one stream and use that in all three drawings. Yeah. That I think saves you some time there. So email us those piss drawings at theboboyspodcast@gmail.com. Of course, follow us across social media at theboboyspod on Instagram, on TikTok. We're still on Twitter X, but we're looking into Blue Sky. I think that might be the move over there. We are YouTubers. Hey, guys.
Hey,
so,
guys.
Of course, subscribe to the BO Boys YouTube channel. So much content up there right now. So check that out. 5 stars on Apple Podcasts. And, man, I think that's it, guys. I think we've got it.
Pat, I'm finished. Yep. You've said it all, maybe too much.
Yeah, definitely.
And there's nothing left to be said.
Oh, thank God. I'm out of here.
Except for until next time.
We'll smell you
at
the box office.